justice and peace. That means we're supposed to be just. And remember in Hebrew and in Greek, you can't separate two words. You can't separate the word justice from righteousness. They're the same word in Greek and Hebrew.
Excuse me, I'm just going to grab a chair.
Not a problem. Welcome. Okay, now, by the way, there is, this comes into English in this way. It's a French word that the English adopted, and we got two words from that. One is pity. You can see that, can't you? The other is piety. And you can see that too, can't you? Okay, notice. Pity doesn't mean pity as we think of it now, but compassion. So notice, what is that word again saying to us? You can't be pious without being compassionate. Not if you're going to truly accept the word. The two do go together. Okay? Who did you say Jesus is in relation to us?
Our brother.
Our brother. And who else is our brother? And even, notice, Jesus says to Paul, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Who does Paul think he's persecuting?
Others.
People. The voice from heaven says, me. As you've done it to one of the least of these, my brothers, you've done it to me. You've seen this, haven't you? Okay. That's what. Okay. Now, Lois, would you start again at verse 4?
John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins.
Okay, any question there? Okay, read the next sentence.
And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins.
Purification, refining process, right? Now, how many of the people went?
All of them, they say.
What did Malachi say? What did you read in Malachi? He's going to refine the Levites who represent them all. Okay? Go ahead. Now, notice, by the way, one of the things that we you will hear sometimes is, well, that's typical gospel exaggeration. And what people are referring to, you know, if your eye offends you, pull it out. If your hand offends you, cut it off, that kind of thing. And so I think that is not typical exaggeration. I think that's saying what is to happen. Okay, go ahead.
Now, John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey.
Okay. Would you turn to 1 Kings, please? Okay. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings. So it's over quite a way, but if you get Chronicles, you're going too far. Second, did I say, I'm sorry, Second Kings, yes, please, sorry. Second Kings. Second Kings, chapter one. Second Kings, chapter one. Okay, Jim, let's read it started, verse five.
Verse five. The messengers.
Excuse me, I need to, I suggest, read verse two first.
Two. Uzziah had fallen through the lattice of his roof terrace at Samaria and had been injured. So he sent out messengers with the instructions, "Go inquire of Beelzebub, the god of Ekron, whether I shall recover from this injury." Meanwhile, the angel of the Lord said to Elijah the Tishbite, "Go intercept the messengers of Samaria's king and ask them, 'Is it because there's no God in Israel that you're going to inquire of Beelzebub, the god of Ekron? For this the Lord says, you shall not leave the bed upon which you lie. Instead, you shall die.'" And with that, Elijah departed.
Okay, notice, it sounds like Abraham, doesn't it? God said, go. Elijah went. Go ahead.
The messengers then returned to Uzziah, who asked them, "Why have you returned?" "A man came back to us," they answered, "who said, 'Go to us, go back to the king who sent you, and tell him, the Lord says, is it because there's no God in Israel that you are ascending to inquire of Beelzebub, the god of Ekron? For this you shall not leave the bed upon which you lie. Instead, you shall die.' The king asked them, 'What was the man like who came to you and said these things to you?' 'Wearing a hairy garment,' they replied, 'with a leather girdle about his loins.' 'It is Elijah the Tishbite,' he exclaimed."
Ah, notice how he's dressed.
Like Jonathan.
And like John the Baptist. Maybe I should say John the Baptist like Elijah. Notice how many ways this is saying that. Okay, Lois, continue to read.
"He proclaimed, 'The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals.'"
Okay, notice, is John promoting himself?
No.
Notice, he's preparing the way, right? Now he says, "I'm not, what is that image? I'm not worthy to loosen his sandals." Who loosened somebody's sandals?
The servants.
Because remember, what did people do when you entered a house?
You take off your shoes.
And what was the host supposed to do? Not personally, but servants. Notice, he's saying, "I'm not even worthy to be a servant to wash the feet." I want to jump way ahead here now to something that all of you will recognize. Notice, John the Baptist is not worthy to wash, to loosen his sandals, let alone wash the feet of Jesus. What did Jesus do? Wash the feet of Jesus. Wash it. He said, notice, "I came not to be served, but to serve," and made himself the humblest. Again, our God, our God did what? Notice, what a host wouldn't even do, the servants of those, and John the Baptist says, "I'm not worthy to loosen this man's sandals." Keep reading, Lewis.
I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit.
Okay, notice right there. What is that looking forward to? Pentecost, right? Pentecost. And so notice in the, right in the beginning of this book, this book of Mark, it's going toward, looking toward the finality of things too.
Would the Holy Spirit, is that like a branding or like the final seal of approval? Or?
It's like a, well, Ezekiel, remember, said, do you remember what Ezekiel said? That one of, in the part of the prophetic covenant, I will pour clean water upon you and cleanse you from all your idols. I will take your hearts of stone and give you a human heart. And I will send my spirit within you so that you will not be taught, need to be taught, but from the least to the greatest, you will know. So, notice, it's a new heart. We're recreated. This is the reason, rebirth, born from above. Remember, John, unless you receive birth from above, unless you're born again, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. We're given a new heart. Does that mean that from that point on we don't still have the old inclinations?
No.
Alas, no.
So when we go to confession, that's sort of a rebaptism.
Actually, that was what the church first called it. In effect, it's rebaptism. That's that repentance of sin. Yeah. Well said. Good connection. Good connection.
So the water washes the sin away so that the Spirit can enter. And the repentance is the thing you got to have to make it.
That's right. If there's no repentance,
it doesn't work.
That's right. And that's the reason confirmation is so important. And notice, at confirmation, what happens? I mean, literally, what happens that we can see? Anointed with the Spirit.
I want to go back to this Kings here, this Beelzebub or whatever.
Yeah.
Is that the devil then?
That is a pagan god. Beelzebub was regarded as a servant of Baal.
Did I pronounce that correctly? That it wasn't Beelzebub, the devil.
It's by...
It was double A, Beelzebub.
Actually, there are different spellings of it, so you probably pronounce it correctly in your translation. Beelzebub, Beelzebub. Both those are used.
They're both the same?
They're both the same.
So is it evil spirit? Or
Notice in the text itself, it said, go ask the God. So he's regarded as a God. The Psalms say the gods of the old religion, in effect, the gods of the other religions are devils, are demons.
So when Jesus went into the desert after being baptized...
Good. Hang on. That's right. Where are we going? Okay. Lois, read.
In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, you are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased. And the Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan, and he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news."
Okay, this is the full introduction, and I'm going to go back and we're going to look at the parts of it now. But in regard to the wilderness, I want you to notice something. What happened when Jesus was baptized?
He saw it says here he saw the heavens being torn open and the Spirit like a dove.
He saw the heavens torn open. That seems to be a reference to the material in third Isaiah, which we didn't look at much. I'm gonna turn there quickly and just read you a selection or two. Okay, it could be 64 or 63, depending on the translation. "Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence, as when fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations might tremble in your presence." And then it goes on to tell 64 and 65 and 66 all deal with, it's a kind of a prayer and a promise, a prayer and a series of promises. But torn apart is not a typical statement about the heavens, obviously.
Did the people that witnessed this see that too, or?
We don't know. We do know that from the other gospel accounts, certainly the apostles who were with him knew something dramatic was happening. Okay, now I want you to notice something again. A dove descending like a dove, it says. It doesn't say a dove. It says like a dove, right? What's the symbolism of a dove? Yes. Yes. I mean, that must be almost universal, because you certainly see it a lot. Okay, read verse 11, Lois.
"And a voice came from heaven, 'You are my son, the beloved. With you I am well pleased.'"
Here again, it's a combination of at least two quotations. Now turn to Isaiah 42. Back to Isaiah again. Isaiah 42. Remember, go to Psalms and go toward the New Testament. Okay. Okay, got it? Isaiah 42, verse 1, and I want you to read verse 1.
"Here is my servant, whom I uphold, my chosen one, with whom I am pleased. Upon him..."
Recognize anything?
Same thing.
"With whom I am pleased."
Not well pleased.
Yeah, okay. "Or in whom my soul delights" is another translation of it. Okay, that's the first part of this, right? It's the last part. It's the last part, not the first part. "Now, you are my son." Turn to Psalm 2. Crowning of a shall I say, a Davidic king. Okay. Jim, you got it?
Mm-hmm.
Start reading at verse 7.
Verse 7. I will proclaim the decree of the Lord, who said to me, you are my son. Today I am your father.
Okay. Today you are begotten. Today you are my, I am your father. Okay. The you are my son, the beloved with you I'm well pleased. Now this is a combination of a coronation song and Isaiah 40. Now let's go back to Isaiah. Isaiah 40 and is the first of a series of what? Do you remember? Let's get back to the first.
Promises.
Pardon?
Promises of salvation.
Yes. And it's also the beginning of material that is going to be, you're going to have a series of servant songs. Do you remember the servant songs? I'm at, I'm just finding my place here, 42. Look down at a note in your Bibles, I'll bet you.
Psalm 42?
No, Isaiah 40. Isaiah 42.
Isaiah 42.
Okay. You've got a note there, I believe. Can you see it? Dale, what do you find there?
Three other servants of the Lord of hosts.
Pardon?
Three other servants of the Lord of hosts.
Notice this is the first servant song. Okay. What was this? Remember the servant? What? Do you remember the servant song? So, okay, notice. I'd like you to turn to Isaiah 50 because you're going to recognize that even more. Isaiah 50, starting at verse 4. Okay, Dale, you got it?
Mm-hmm.
Read, please.
The Lord God has given me a well-trained tongue, that I might know how to speak to the weary, a word that will rouse them. Morning after morning, he opens my ear that I may hear, and I have not rebelled, have not turned back. I gave my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who plucked my beard. My face I did not shield from buffets and spitting. The Lord God is my help, therefore I am not disgraced. I have set my face like flint, knowing that I shall not be put to shame. He is near who upholds my right. If anyone wishes to oppose me, let us appear together. Who disputes my right, let him confront me. See, the Lord God is my help, who will prove me wrong. Lo, they will all wear out like cloth, the moth will eat them up. Who among you fears the Lord? He is his servant's voice and walks in darkness without any light. Trusting in the name of the Lord and relying on his God. All of you kindle flames and carry out your fiery darts. Walk by the light of your own fire and by the fires you have burnt.
Okay, would you turn now to, let's say, skip, not to 52. 52, verse 13.
See, my servant shall prosper, he shall be raised high, and even as many were opposed, so marred was his look beyond that of man, and his appearance beyond that of mortals. So shall he startle many nations, because of him, kings shall stand speechless. Those who you have not been called shall be.
Skip 53:2, would you?
53:2? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot before the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor a force that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by men, a man suffering, accustomed to infirmity, one of those from whom men hide their faces, burned and beheld him in no esteem.
Okay, now what? All of us are familiar with that, aren't we? Who do we associate with that?
Jesus.
Yeah. And they took, now, let me remind you of something. What were the apostles and the early Christians reading to talk about Jesus?
The Old Testament.
What I've just been referring you to, right? They didn't have the New Testament. How long was it before they had parts of the New Testament?
70, 80 years, 100 years,
50.
Well, if Mark was written between 64 and 70 AD or BCE,
but they wouldn't all have it,
right? Right.
Yeah. So by about 100, some of the material began to circulate. But it wouldn't have been the gospel according to John, because that was not written until between 90 and 100.
Till when?
90 and 100. And all of this material was not yet, the New Testament material was not gathered till hundreds of years as a book. Even as late as the 1400s in England, people were not thinking New Testament the way we think New Testament. So notice, what I'm taking you back to is what Christians read and taught Jesus, using to teach Jesus. You can see, and you can see then how the gospel writers can bring that and put that into, in a very concise way, into Mark. Questions? What is this saying about Jesus? That he would, the voice from heaven, God the Father, right? The voice, to put together a Psalm 2, a coronation song, and a suffering servant. What is that saying about Jesus?
He's not going to be the strong warrior king that everybody wants him to be.
That's right, he's not going to be the warlike king that everybody's expecting, but he is a king. What's he going to be?
A servant.
A suffering servant. Despised, was he?
Yes.
Did they spit in his face?
Pulled his beard.
Notice, you've got that in Isaiah. And so, from the beginning of Mark, we know what kind of Jesus we're reading, looking for, looking at. What a Savior. I keep thinking, our God is like that? What are we supposed to be like?
Like him.
I feel a bit inadequate, I don't know about you. Okay, start down with verse 12.
and the spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness.
Notice, that's the same spirit that descended like a dove. And drove is the word. Start again, please.
And the spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan, and he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him.
Okay, do you know anybody else who was, what, for 40 days and 40 nights, even without food?
Noah, or not Noah, but what's that guy in the whale?
No, I'm sorry. Actually, Moses. Moses. Exodus 34. Exodus 34, 28.
Only 40 days up on the mountain.
Pardon?
He spent 40 days up on the mountain.
That's right. That's exactly right. And what do you find here? Verse 28, what do you find? You got it there?
Yes.
Read.
You said 28?
Mm, 28.
Yes. So Moses was there with the Lord for 40 days and 40 nights without eating any food or drinking any water.
Okay. By the way, the other gospel writers say that was true of Jesus. And so what was the first temptation?
To worship Satan.
No, that wasn't the first one.
Food.
First one, turn these stones into bread. Notice. So, by the way, guess who else went for 40 days and nights without food? Elijah.
I got a question.
Yes.
Is Moses by any lineage related to Abraham?
Oh, absolutely. He's a descendant of Abraham.
Oh.
Moses was a Levite.
So that all falls into place real good.
Yeah. You're right.
Touch your
yeah. Okay. All right.
Dumb question.
Yes.
In reading that, at once the Spirit drove him out into the desert. Does that mean literally that he disappeared in front of all these people and he was no longer there but out in the desert?
No, I don't think we need to think of it like that, but he was impelled. He was forced to go. Okay. Notice the Holy Spirit that first sounded very positive. That same voice gave him up. And so, okay, now
I guess, John, and there are a variety of levels at which we look at Scripture. One is the interpretation, obviously, of what we're doing, and one is what is that application of what I'm now understanding to be like. And so, going back to the idea of the Spirit descending during baptism on Jesus, there is also a descent of the Spirit on me when I go through reconciliation. And repentance is more than just whatever that priest, that confessor, is giving us. It's really impelling us to go into the wilderness and to wrestle with those very temptations.
The demons.
The demons. And that's kind of taking it to a different level. But that's really, personally, where that connection comes in. It's not just going, oh, okay, that's good. But it really is, what does that mean for me? For many years, it was like, okay, I said my Our Father, my Hail Mary, I'm gone. But yeah. It really means that we all have to be driven into the wilderness where we are dependent on only one source. And I find that as I've aged, hopefully with that comes that wisdom of going, it is more than just sacramentally going through the sacramental exterior, but it's that sacramental interior that has
new heart.
Yeah, that new heart.
And this whole range of things come to my mind as you said that this is the reason I'm saying, oh God, what was he like and what did he do? And oh, exactly this. That's where we're going with that. Because all knowledge that is not put to use is labeled file and forget. Mm-hmm. Sir Thomas Browne, an 18th century Englishman, said, he was an Anglican clergyman. He said, the older I get, the more simple I become. He said, I know to do, and I don't do it. I know not to do, and I do it. And you know, in this sense, he is paraphrasing St. Paul. That which I would do, he said, the sin within impels me. And so, yeah, we're in the wilderness.
And that's where many of our church fathers sought their wisdom, the church fathers and
the
mothers,
desert
the
fathers.
Desert fathers, the desert mothers. And then they were called back, many of them, from that life to now bring their wisdom of understanding of what it meant to be in that wilderness. And that's what began to build that Christian church, if you will.
The church, huh? St. Augustine said of L.A., we know him as Bishop of Hippo, but he wanted to be a cloistered monk. And he said he was torn. He was called by the people and by God to be a bishop. But that meant he could not pray and be in the presence of God. And because he got to attend to all these things coming at him from every direction. And I think that's a special reason for us to pray for our pastor and our bishop and our pope. Because everything is coming at them. And somebody was saying, well, he gets to hear the good stuff. I said some of the best and some of the worst. So yeah, you hit the nail right on the head. Anybody else have a comment? You see why I said this material makes me feel so inadequate. Okay, but at the same time, what do we always know? Read that once again. Verse 13.
He was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan, and he was with wild beasts, and the angels waited on him.
Let us not forget, we're not alone. We have the presence of the Spirit. It doesn't say the Spirit departed from him at any point. Notice? And now read the last part. 14.
Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God, and saying, the time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news.
Okay, now notice, in effect, that's the whole gospel. We just read the whole gospel according to Mark. The rest gives us the details. This gives us, I think I've mentioned to you that the young priest asked the old priest, how do you prepare a sermon? He says, well, I tell them what I'm going to tell them, then I tell them, and then I tell them what I told them. All right. Mark has just told us what he's going to tell us. And So, because we're looking at, did you notice anything connected with covenant in that last sentence? The time is fulfilled. And remember what that word means. Fulfilled. Means filled full. Completed. So the covenant promises are completed in Jesus. Next time, we'll start looking at Luke. And I'd like you to go there real quickly with me. Next, we'll go over from Mark. And I want to show you how long his introduction is. So we'll be doing this one for a while, I think. Okay, notice you have a short introduction, and then you have the birth of John and Jesus. You have the Annunciation to Mary and to Zechariah. And even if we go to the point where Jesus is tempted, baptized, tempted, that takes us through the first four chapters of Luke. I think we won't go that far, that deeply into Luke, but know that Luke takes that short bit from Mark and expands it to four chapters. So, I will try to give you a written form of this next time. I'll do my best, and you will know that I'm not adequately saying. Shall we pray? In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Gracious Father, we give you thanks for your word. And Father, may it convict our hearts so that we recognize that if our Savior was our servant, how much more are we to wash the feet of all your sons and daughters? How much more are we to have compassion on all, especially those most in need? And Father, help us never to forget that compassion without a relationship to you is incomplete. Or that a relationship with you without compassion is incomplete. We pray for the fullness of your being, Lord. We pray that we may be open to your presence through Christ our Lord. Amen.
What happened when you start the course?
That happens to me too.